Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J traveled to Biola University to speak at the Summit Leadership Conference for high school and college students. She's about to give a two-part talk on the sexual revolution and its victims. Part two is in the next podcast. Stay tuned.
Please welcome Dr. Morse.
Hey, everybody. Good morning. How are you? So there we go. There we go. So you know what? This is the Ruth Institute dream. We have a dream that every child be welcomed into a loving home with a married mother and father. How about that dream? Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. So all the things, you know, a lot of times people think about Christianity, they think about what we're against. But the main thing you have to think about is what we're for. All of the no's are pointing towards this yes. That's the main thing to keep in mind. Now, as he's mentioned, the Ruth Institute is an interfaith organization. We focus a lot on young people, on youth, so we're very happy to have the opportunity here to be here to talk with you. Now, let me just get a little show of hands here, just so I can kind of see. How many of you have graduated from high school? Great, great. How many of you are still in high school? Hey, there's segregation. This is age segregation here. You see that? The high school kids are in back. Let's go. Who rigged that up? Man. Okay. How many of you are from California? Okay. All right. All right. I live in San Diego. Right on. The best town ever. America's finest city. That's what we call ourselves. Okay. So I want to just mention to you that at the end of the summer, in August, I will be speaking again in San Francisco at an event put on by the Archdiocese of San Francisco. Archbishop Corleone invited me to come and speak, and the subject is natural family planning. If any of you are interested in that, if any of your parents might be interested in it, because it's not really a youth-oriented thing, you know, but if any of you are interested in it, we have a couple of flyers down here that you can take home and share. So what we're going to do today is I have two talks for you, and I'm going to break this into two separate hours. And the roadmap of what we're going to cover are these three points. First of all, the family is the basis of society. You've probably heard that a million times, that the family is the most basic unit of society. We hear it so often that it becomes a cliche. So I want to spend a little time talking to you about why it's really true. Okay? Secondly, I want to talk about how the family is broken. Now, a lot of you probably already know that, but I want to give you a little meat on those bones so we know what we're talking about. And then finally, the Ruth Institute is here to heal the family. And I very much appreciate what was said here prior to your talk. I don't know what went on last night that you were all reacting to, but our mission is a mission of healing. My background is in public policy and economics and things like that. And so I'm used to kind of being a wonk, you know what I mean? And testifying in front of state legislatures, and you're really trying to get them to shape up and think and use their head and all that. And they won't do it, which is kind of interesting. They won't do it. And so we have refocused our energies, not so much on trying to change public policy, although there are plenty of policies that need to be changed, not that we think that's unimportant, but there are many wounded people in our culture as a result of the sexual revolution. And so our mission is to focus on helping to heal those people who've been wounded by the sexual revolution. So over the period of the two talks, I'm going to ask you, we'll cover these three points over the 2 hours. I'm going to ask you your questions about genderless marriage. I want you to keep those till the end, until the second part, because that's what I'll do most of the time in the second part. So we'll have plenty to talk about in the first hour, trust me. And by the way, you probably know that later this week, the United States Supreme Court will be issuing an opinion on the marriage question, and it is almost certain that they will find one way or the other that the United States Constitution requires genderless marriage. that a state cannot have a male-female requirement for marriage. They're almost certainly going to do that. So we can talk about that in the questions and answers and stuff if you want to. All right. So let's start with the family as the basis of society. I'm going to start by talking with you about what the family ought to be. We have to have a picture of what we're trying to do in this institution called family. And we're going to look at that in two separate ways. First, we're going to look at it in the natural realm, the sociological, social science realm. And then secondly, we'll look at it at the theological, supernatural level. Okay, because we want both of those things working together. It's one of the highlights of Christian anthropology, you could say, the Christian view of the human person, is that what we believe is true in the natural order does not and cannot conflict with what we believe from divine revelation and the theological order. Those two things work together. That's part of our belief. So, what the family ought to be in the sociological realm. So, let me start this part by just telling you a little bit about my own personal journey. I have a doctorate in economics. I taught at Yale University for 5 years. I taught at George Mason University for 10 years. And my plan for myself when I was a young woman in the 70s and 80s, my plan was that I would get tenure at a major university, and as soon as I got tenure, I would have a baby at the end of the semester, right, like at the end of the beginning of the summer, and then I would take care of the baby during the summer, and then in September I would put the baby in daycare and go right back to work. That was the plan that I had for myself, and indeed that's what most of my female colleagues did. I had colleagues who, among them women colleagues, who had perhaps 10 children among them. None of them had ever missed a day of work. None of them had ever missed a class. That was considered normal, right? So imagine my surprise when the baby did not arrive during the month that I had set aside for it. So my husband and I were confronted with a 4.5 year infertility crisis, which for me was a whole crisis of faith, because infertility was the first time in my adult life that I couldn't get what I wanted by working harder and trying harder and being smart and following all the rules. See, I thought if I was on that track, you know, I could make it all work and it would all be great, and that I was entitled to have it all work out, see. So this was the first time that that turned out not to be true, and so it was the first time that I was willing to allow God to have a say in my life. I had been brought up as a Roman Catholic and was a well-brought-up Roman Catholic, pre-Vatican II Catholic, those of you who know what that means. Do we have any Catholics here? People who, okay, so most of you are evangelicals, you don't know much about this world. So the infertility experience is what brought me back to the practice of the Catholic faith and where I've been ever since. But I was out of the church for about 12 years, and during that period of time I did some crazy stuff, which is how I got to be an expert on the sexual revolution, because I was a full participant there for a while, which is how I know that it doesn't work. Anyway, so because of that whole transformative process of the conversion or reversion experience which I had, I began to let go of things and to kind of let go of controlling everything. And so by 1991, my husband and I were ready to let go of our dream of having kids ourselves, and we applied to adopt from a Romanian orphanage. Now in 1991, you might remember your history, this is right after the Berlin Wall has come down, is that this is the beginning of Eastern European children being available for adoption. And we were in the first group of people to really get to do that, to bring kids over from Eastern Europe. So we adopted a little boy from a Romanian orphanage. We got a phone call from the from the social worker saying, we have a little boy for you. We know his name and his birth date. He's described as being in good health. He'll be 2.5 years old by the time you get him. What do you say? And we said, sure. Why not? When you've been infertile for 4 years, you don't really believe a baby's actually going to show up. You think it's like, yeah, whatever, you know. My period was 30 seconds late, so maybe I'm pregnant. I mean, this is the mindset that you get into when you're infertile. No, really, you know, and then you're crushed every time, you know. So anyway, we have been through that roller coaster. So we're like, yes, sure, send the little boy over. It'll be great, you know. And then 10 days later, I went to the doctor with a head cold and found out that I was pregnant. Yeah, so we ended up having 2 children within 6 months' time, which is a record even for a Catholic. That's how I knew I was back in the faith, you know, fitting in with all the other people and stuff, you know. So here, but our little guy who came over from Romania, he and a lot of his peers had a lot of developmental issues, right? Because he couldn't talk, he couldn't utter a single word in any language, he didn't know his own name, he did not respond even to the sound of the human voice, okay? So we didn't realize, my husband and I didn't realize that this is not normal. Okay, so our pediatrician had to smack us and basically say, you got to get this kid to speech therapy, and you need to do this, and you need to do that. And trust me, my doctorate in economics did not prepare me for what I had to do here. Okay, they just didn't cover this in econ school. And my husband is an engineer, if anything, less prepared for what we have to deal with. Okay, so I see you get the picture here. So here we are, we're a pair of nerds, basically, right? My husband. And that's a good thing. Nerds, good, right? We have any nerds out here? Any self? Right on. All right. So nerds, that's great. So here we are, a pair of nerds, and we have these two kids in our nursery, and we're, you know, naturally as nerds, we see a controlled experiment. Right? And the controlled experiment is, what difference does it make whether you have a mom and a dad in your life? That's the question. What difference does it make whether you have a mom and a dad in your life? And of course, the answer is it makes all the difference. It makes an enormous difference. The development of the child depends on having a relationship with their mommy. Okay? And so we discovered that there are two very crucial things that can go wrong if you don't have a mom and a dad in your life. Okay? And they both have to do with infancy. That the scariest thing that can happen is that the child can, and by the way, before I go into any of this, let me tell you, my son is fine. Okay? He's 26 years old and he's fine. If I forget to say that, somebody will come up and say, how's your son? My son's fine. Okay. In fact, sometimes he comes with me to events and helps me pass out literature and things like that. So he's a really great guy and we're real proud of him. But anyway, one of the scary things that can happen with an attachment disorder, with a child who has no parents during infancy, is what is called attachment disorder. Now, attachment disorder is a very scary thing because if you never really bond with somebody, you don't develop a conscience. Now, all of you guys know all about the conscience, and you probably have pretty good consciences. But you don't realize, most people don't realize, that in order to have a conscience at all, you have to first care about somebody. You have to first care what somebody thinks about you. And the first person you care about is your mommy. Right, because when you cry, you wet your diaper, you're hungry, whatever it is, you cry, and what happens? Mommy shows up. Mommy picks you up. Mommy rocks you. She takes care of the problem. She's looking at you. She's loving on you the whole time. She's taking care of your needs. Okay? And that's when you begin to accept that another person is the good in your life, that another person matters, that particular person matters, but that in general, human attachment is really, really important. If nobody comes, this is the saddest thing ever. If nobody comes when the baby cries, the baby starts to turn inward on themselves. See? And they stop looking out there for other people to care about them or care for them. And as a matter of fact, sometimes these kids, you get kids from an orphanage situation like this, and people will say, what a good baby, she never cries. That's profoundly pathological to be a baby that doesn't cry. Babies are supposed to cry. The reason they don't cry is because they've given up. See? And what can happen is that they don't care about anybody. And so therefore, when you do the normal stuff that you do at the age of two, you can start talking. At the age of two, you can say, don't do that. You wouldn't like it if your sister did that to you, so don't do that to your sister. Okay? But the only reason they accept that from you is because they already care what you think. See, they care if mommy's upset. And if they don't care what mommy's whether mommy's upset or not, then that whole question doesn't even make sense. I don't care if my sister doesn't like it. What the heck, right? So if you got a two-year-old who's a problem, you can run, pick him up, get him out of the problem. You got a 12-year-old who has no conscience, who does whatever they can get away with, you can't go get him and get him out of trouble. See, you can't just pick him up and get him out of trouble. In fact, they become dangerous and sometimes scary to people. You see what I mean? If you have no conscience at all, all right? So not having a conscience is something that a free society simply can't afford very many of, right? People who truly do anything they can get away with, that takes a lot of trouble, a lot of money, a lot of effort to control people who can't control themselves or who won't control themselves. So this is the sense in which the family is the foundation of society. Because without the family, the personality doesn't even develop correctly so that you can be sociable. So it's a very important thing. Second piece, the second thing that can happen with children who are deprived of human contact in infancy. And by the way, you sometimes see this in orphanage kids. You sometimes see it in foster kids. You will sometimes see it in kids whose parents are preoccupied with drugs or their newest love life or something like that. You know, it's not just an orphanage thing. It can happen a lot of different ways. And it doesn't happen in all of those situations, right? So not every foster kid has this. I don't want you to get that idea. But it's a risk. You see, it's a risk, it's a problem. So the other thing that can happen is that the child is that the brain doesn't develop properly. There's a new diagnosis that was discovered actually in the Eastern European orphanages, and it's called institutional autism. Do you guys have pictures of monkeys on your slides? Okay, I didn't bring the monkey pictures because I got other stuff to show you. So right by the picture of the monkey, write down institutional autism. Okay, because look at that monkey. Look at that poor little monkey. He's like all huddled up in the corner, right? They believe, what they found was a whole bunch of kids with autistic-like symptoms. And what they believe happened is that those kids weren't born autistic, as many kids are born. Most kids who have autism are born with autism. But you can induce it, and here's how you induce it. When a baby's born, the brain's not fully developed prior to birth. If it were fully developed before birth, you would not be able to make it down the birth canal without killing your mother, which would be a problem. Be an obvious design defect. God would not put us together that way. So when you're born, your brain needs to develop, and the part of your brain that develops is called the limbic brain, which controls your ability to be in relationship with other people. And where does that happen? When your mommy's holding you just like this. See, most mommies will do this some of the time. What's happening? The baby, when the baby's born, they're looking for something. They're looking for a face. They're looking for somebody to relate to. They're looking for their mommy. And so every time you go like this, every time mommy's doing this, actually, literally, the brain is developing. There are synapses that are firing, connections that are being made that allow the limbic brain to develop. And the limbic brain, by the way, is the part of the brain that allows you to intuit other people's emotions, allows you to feel the buzz of a group if you're out at a ball game and everybody's excited, everybody cheers. It's more exciting if there's a lot of people there than if you're watching it on your phone by yourself. Right? You know what I'm talking about? Okay, for an autistic person, they don't get it. They don't get why it matters to have a crowd of people around them, but they don't feel it the same way, okay? So it's that part of the brain that needs to be developed. So this is the most, in a way, beautiful thing, which is that we develop the capacity for relationship when we are in relationship with our mommies, right? And you think about how much time moms spend looking at the baby, okay? Looking like this. And even when you're not holding them, immediately taking care of them. Let's say I'm over here doing the dishes and the baby is on the counter in their rockaroo, right? You know what I'm talking about? They're sitting there in their little thing. And they make a little noise. They make a little noise. And they go, bah, yeah. And mommy goes, yeah, yeah. Right? Now, if a science guy were to come in there and say, Mrs. Morse, what were you doing from 9:30 a.m. to 10:30 a.m.? I would say, I'm doing the dishes. But that doesn't tell the whole story, does it? Because every time my baby makes a noise, I'm talking to her. I'm reacting to her. She looks at me, I look at her. Every time. That's huge. Right? That's a huge piece of child development that's going on, and we don't even notice it, right? Because we think we're doing the dishes. See? So all of that is a way of saying that the family is really, truly necessary for the development of the human personality. That's the point. And while mommy's doing all this stuff, where's daddy? Well, he better be taking care of business, because if she needs to bust out and go earn a living or something, so it's not going to be as great. Right? Daddy's in the background supporting that relationship. At that moment in the infancy stage, daddy needs to be supporting that relationship. Of course, he's going to have his own relationship. And over time, as the child develops, his relationship comes into its own and becomes more important. But the fact is, mom and dad working together are the gold standard for child development. And if you don't have that going on, you have crippled your society. Okay? So this is what I mean when I say the family is the foundation of society. This is what the family is supposed to look like. Oh, look, and I do have my slides up there. Oh, boy, I hope I have the right slides. Oh, boy. Oh, well, whatever. There's the monkey. Okay, so let me talk about now what the family ought to be from the theory. This is what happens when you redo your slides the night before, okay? High risk. All right. What the family ought to be in the supernatural realm. You have no doubt heard the biblical phrase that it is not good for the man to be alone. When does God say that? Right before he creates Eve, right? It is not good for the man to be alone. Well, science more or less has just shown us that it's not even possible for man to be alone, right? You leave the baby alone, the baby dies, okay? And so we attach to each other. The infant attaches to their mother. We as adults in a sexual relationship, we attach to one another because we need one another. Now, we come from many different faith traditions. I was told that. I guess there aren't too many Catholics in the room, but all kinds of Protestant groups are represented here. One thing I believe that all of our faith traditions teach is this. The human person is meant for love. Does everybody agree with that? The human person was meant for love. The human person was created for love. And I love this quotation from Pope John Paul II, who has recently been canonized, so he's now a saint. We now call him Saint John Paul II. In one of his early writings as Pope, he said this. He said, "Man cannot live without love. He remains a being that is incomprehensible for himself. His life is senseless if love is not revealed to him, if he does not encounter love, if he does not experience it and make it his own." Now, he goes on to say that the encounter everybody needs is the encounter with Jesus Christ. That's where he's going with this. But we can see that this applies perfectly to every human person at birth. We need to encounter love. And our first encounter with love is our mommy. See? And if that's not there, your life is senseless. You can't figure out what you are, who you are. You don't know what to do with yourself. So this is a very important theological point, right? It's not just a physiological, sociological point. It's also a theological point. I include a slide of this book and book cover because this is a very important work by John Paul II called Male and Female, He Created Them, A Theology of the Body. It's a tough going. Actually, it's a big philosophical work, but I wanted you to just be aware of it. And there are a number of, you know, Theology of the Body for Dummies type books out there, you know, they're kind of translated down so you can use it, but it's a very profound body of work. So I want to say, before I leave this section, I want to just speak briefly about sex and the cosmos, what I call sex and the cosmos. In 2011, I had the opportunity to go to Hong Kong Baptist University and present in Hong Kong on a lot of these themes having to do with marriage and the family. And at that conference, somebody said that the Confucian view of marriage and the family was exactly mirrored the Confucian view of the cosmos, that there was some kind of parallel between what they thought the universe was all about and what they thought man and woman coming together was all about. And I thought to myself, that's really interesting. I never thought of that before. And then I realized, we think that too. As Christians, we think that too. St. Paul tells us that, doesn't he? He tells us in Ephesians 5 that there is a parallel between husband and wife and Christ and the church. Right? It's right there. And we also think this. We think, where did the universe even come from? Where did the whole world come from? It came into being because the Trinity loved it into existence. The Trinity loved one another so much that creation was inevitable somehow. Right? And so the universe exists because of love. And what do we believe about each individual human person? We exist because of love. Because our mothers and fathers loved us into existence. Even if our mothers and fathers are complete boneheads and didn't really mean it, or, you know, whatever, what's God's point? God's participation is always that he loved you into existence. God gets a vote every time, no matter what kind of contraception you use or how many times you do artificial reproduction, reproductive technology, and you think you have it all under control and so on and so forth. God gets a vote every time. Every person in this room was loved into existence by God. And so our view of the cosmos mirrors our view of human sexuality. And then I started thinking, you know, a lot of our secular, non-believing friends also believe that the cosmos and sex are related. And here's what they believe. I think this is what they believe. Maybe you've talked about this in some of your talks. Don't they believe something like the universe came into being by random atoms bumping into each other for no particular reason at all? Is that right? Pure materialist cause with no purpose, right? It could be purely random. And look at what people's sex lives are on the average college campus. Not Biola, but on the average average college campus, what are people's sex lives like? They are random people. People are acting like random atoms bumping into each other for no particular reason at all. That's the hookup culture. It's a perfect metaphor for the hookup culture. So I want to put that in your mind for this reason. Which view is more appealing? If you were going to sell one of these two views, which would you rather believe? Would you rather believe that God loved us all into existence or that it's random, it's completely random? I just want you to have that in the back of your minds as you do your various kinds of apologetics. Okay, so now let's talk about the fact that the family is broken. And in this part where I talk about how the family is broken, I could talk about any number of ways in which the family is broken, because there are a lot of ways in which we're shattered and we have a lot of problems right now. But today, I'm going to pay particular attention to the issue of genderless marriage. And by the way, you'll notice I never use the term same-sex marriage. I never use the term gay marriage. I'm not going to go into that now, but in your notes, in the bonus section of your notes, you will see that I have a little bit of discussion about that, about why I don't use that term some of the other terms that you might use. But anyway, so in this part, talking about the family being broken, I'm going to talk about what is the sexual revolution and how does the genderless marriage issue and genderless marriage generally, how does it fit in to the overall train, the historical progress of the sexual revolution? And then finally, we want to understand how redefining marriage is going to impact society. So after Thursday or Friday, whenever it's going to be, what's going to happen after that? You know, that'll be part of what we want to talk about. And I think I'm going to get through items 1 and 2 before our break, and then you can ask questions about the things that we've already talked about. All right, so let's talk about what is the sexual revolution. Okay. Have you heard this term before, the sexual revolution? Okay, so you know roughly what we're talking about, but I want to give it a little bit of precision here so that we know exactly what we're talking about. I break it down into 3 basic points. First of all, is the idea that sex and childbearing can be separated from one another, and in fact, should be separated from one another. That a good and decent society will break the bonds, will break the connection between sex and procreation. Do you recognize that, okay, as part of our culture, okay? The second point is that sex and childbearing can both be separated from marriage, okay? That sex and childbearing can both be separated from marriage. Do you recognize that? We're allowed to have sex with anybody, anytime, anywhere. People who say you shouldn't, there's something wrong with them, basically, right? So you probably all have people tell you there's something wrong with you, because you don't go along with all this stuff, right? So, right, a good and decent society should allow people to have both sex and childbearing outside of marriage. And so what's being done here is that the umbrella of marriage, which covers, in our view, which covers your sexual activity, your childbearing, and your love for your spouse, all united under one thing, under the heading of marriage, that's being broken apart. Okay, that's being spread out into different places. So your sex life need not have anything to do with your marriage, and neither need to have anything to do necessarily with children and so on and so forth. And if you go through the possible combinations, you can see all the different policies and social practices that are covered under this understanding. Now, at the beginning of the sexual revolution, the idea was, the first idea was, that we're going to be able to have sex without having babies. And everybody thought that sounded like a lot of fun. And I can tell you, I was there. We all thought it was going to be a lot of fun. Problem is now we're to the point where we're having babies without having sex. Did you know that? You can have babies without having sex. Yeah, I don't have to explain this anymore. Everybody knows how this is done. You can have babies without having sex, which I'm pretty sure is not as much fun as the old-fashioned way. But there we are. Here we are in our culture at this point. So those are the first two points of the sexual revolution. The third is the concept that men and women are completely interchangeable. That, in fact, the sex of the body is not particularly significant. And any differences that you see between men and women are all socially constructed, probably evidence of some kind of injustice, and we ought to do something about it. Okay? And if you wish to reconstruct your body, to change your gender, that's perfectly okay. That's why we're seeing so much of transgenderism these days. It could be because it's the next step in the logic of the sexual revolution. For a while, people thought that what we need to do is to have, if we just had enough social and cultural software, we could overwrite the differences in the body. Right? We could overwrite and sort of wipe out the differences between men and women. Now we're to the point where we're also using hardware to overwrite the differences between men and women. So, but in both cases, in all cases, what we're saying is that the body is not particularly significant. And you kind of get to do with it whatever you want, whether it's at the cultural level or the technological level. We get to do anything we want with our bodies. Now, this image that I have on the screen here, I chose this image for a reason. You'll see that there's a young person there in the foreground, and then there are six adults in the back, two groups of three. I got this cartoon from an article in the Boston Globe. And the Boston Globe had written an article, which I would call a puff piece, I would call a propaganda piece. The point of the Boston Globe's article was how wonderful it's going to be someday when children can have three, four, five, or even six parents. And so the point of the story was to kind of explain how these six people were somehow related to this child in the foreground. That's not what I want to talk about. What I want to point out to you is their drawing of this child. Look at that child. You can't tell whether that's a boy or a girl. You cannot tell if that's a boy or a girl. And I want to submit to you that they did that deliberately. They knew exactly what they were drawing. They knew exactly what image they were creating, that the future of all of this is the genderless person, the androgynous person, the person where you can't tell if they're male or female. And I didn't draw this cartoon. They drew this cartoon. So I just want to point that out to you. That's why I put that image up there. So now, how does the current issue of genderless marriage fit into the sexual revolution? So I figured this out. You know, I've been talking about these themes since Prop 8, since Proposition 8 in 2008. I was a campaign spokeswoman for Proposition 8 in 2008. And I don't know where you were at that time, but I just want to say for the record that being involved in Proposition 8 was one of the great things of my life. I continue to be proud of it. I don't care what the Supreme Court says about me for that. It was a great campaign. It was a good and decent campaign of good and decent people from all across the spectrum, religiously, income level, racially. Lots and lots of people came together to pass Proposition 8. So anyway, I've been involved in this for a long time, is the point of saying that. And over time, I figured out, why is it people aren't listening? What is going on? What's the disconnect between what we're trying to say and what they're hearing or what is going on with them? And I finally realized that there are certain things that you have to already believe in order to believe that same-sex marriage or genderless marriage or removing the gender requirement for marriage. You have to already have believed certain things, and we were never talking about those things. We were always talking about equality or whatever, or hospital visitation rights. We were always talking about these things, which in the grand scheme of things were not that significant. Where in the background were these things that really are very significant, that people have already accepted so much that they don't even think about it anymore. They're not even talking about it. So I broke it down to three things that I think the typical person already believes before they ever say, yes, by goodness, we need to redefine marriage. First, they already believe that sex is a sterile activity. Okay, sex is a sterile activity. So there's no particular significance to the sexual act, if you believe that. See, if you believe that no baby will ever come, then you can have sex with anybody you want to, and there's no preferred time or place to have sex. There's no preferred context for participating in this sterile sexual act that is really just a recreational activity. Okay? You have to already believe that. Now, and as a culture, we do kind of already believe that. We believe that it's perfectly okay to have sex with anybody you want to, and if your contraception fails you, you can back it up with an abortion. And so no live baby will ever show up. And so therefore, it has no moral significance, it has no social significance. Do you recognize this as our culture? Yeah, people do think this, okay? Now there's just one problem, and you know there are people who are now advocating infanticide. People saying that, you know, all the arguments that apply for why we can kill the fetus also apply for why you can kill a newborn baby. So that's coming up, and that's coming from professors at Ivy League universities. These are not freaks or, you know, fringe people. These are establishment people talking like this. The one problem with this, sex really does make babies. Do you guys know that? Is that cool that I say that? I mean, am I good talking to evangelicals about sex and babies? Is that okay? All right. I always want to check. I don't want to offend anybody here. One time I was on a college campus and I said sex makes babies, and my debate opponent argued with me. Law professor. She argued with me. She said, no, it doesn't. I said, oh? What do you mean? And she said, unprotected sex makes babies. Oh, I see. So instead of babies being the result of the conjugal love of their mothers and fathers, babies are the result of contraceptive failure. So every single little person that you see here is a contraceptive failure. Or they're a choice. They're a choice, right? This is not a very edifying view of the human condition, I would just point out, okay? Problem is, these little contraceptive failures keep popping up all the time, you know, providing counter evidence to this story that we're trying to promote, you know. Sex really does make babies. Now, the second thing you have to believe in order to believe in genderless marriage is you have to believe that marriage is principally about adults and their feelings, and only secondarily about children and their needs. That's what you have to believe. You have to believe it's basically about adults and their feelings, and not about children and their needs. And basically, again, we kind of already believe this. Unilateral or no-fault divorce basically tells people that you are entitled to abandon your child's other parent for any reason or no reason, and that the relationship between you and your child's other parent is something that you can toss away, because you, after all, you may have a new sweetie lined up. And if you have a new sweetie lined up, we can't let a little thing like your child's feelings or needs interfere with you and your bliss. That's what no-fault divorce has done to us. By the way, under fault-based rules, you could always get divorced for cause. Let me just put that out there. Do not be deceived by people telling you that women would be trapped in abusive marriages if it weren't for no-fault divorce. That is not true. Abuse always counted as a fault. Abuse always counted as marital fault and a cause for divorce. So don't be misled by that. We're talking the innovation of no-fault divorce basically said that a blameless spouse could be abandoned. And adultery is now basically something we don't care to penalize, something we don't care to talk about. So this one move, unilateral divorce, basically made it so marriage is no longer permanent and marriage is no longer sexually exclusive. Right. So we've already, in a sense, redefined marriage. But as a matter of fact, there's just one small problem with that, too, which is that kids actually do need their parents. And kids actually do care whether they have their own mom and dad. Kids actually do need their parents. And you know what I noticed as a foster mom? As a foster mom, I dealt with children whose parents had done some pretty bad things or didn't really have it together too well. I mean, that's why they're in foster care, right? The kids always wanted their mom and dad. They didn't care what their parents had done. They always wanted their mom and dad. What they really want, they want mom and dad to get it together and be appropriate parents. And if you think about it, that's what we all want. We all want mom and dad to get it together, you know? So, point three. The other thing you have to believe in order to support the redefinition of marriage is you have to believe that men and women are completely interchangeable. You have to believe that children don't really care whether they have a mother and a father or whether they have two of each, two of one or two of the other. Men, it's all a matter of you know, just pairs of hands. There's no father essence. There's no mother essence. There's no maternal presence. There's no father presence. When the father walks into the house and the kids scatter and they all get quiet, that's not real. A second mom could do that just as well. I don't know about you, but that was kind of how I did parenting. When my husband walked through the door, I just kind of went and relaxed. Don't worry, you'll see. When the time comes, you'll see that this is your... He didn't have to do anything. He was just there. Just the fact that he was there. But the point is, the whole premise behind genderless marriage is that gender doesn't matter. Right? And so you can switch out the gender of the parents, the sex partners, the marriage partners, the parental units. We're all just androgynous parental units here that perform certain functions and tasks. And there's nothing particularly significant about our gender, the gender of our bodies. But we already kind of believe this. We already kind of believe that men and women are perfectly interchangeable. That groundwork for that belief has been laid for a long, long time. Just one problem. Men and women really are different. That's a problem. Do you guys know that? Okay, it's okay to say that men and women are different. I realize that some of your campuses, if I were to come and say that, I would be hooted down and yelled at and so on and so forth. I don't care. It's true that men and women are different. And I also know from experience that if you enter into your married life, if you enter into your life, and try to be some androgynous person and suppress your femininity, in my case, if you suppress your femininity because you think you're supposed to be one of the guys in order to succeed in your profession or whatever reason you might have, you are going to make yourself miserable. You know, and you're gonna hurt people around you if you're expecting them to be like you all the time. Because they're not. They might have perfectly valid guy stuff that they're doing that we, you know, it's mysterious enough, these male things, these male creatures. They're mysterious enough. We don't need to put this layer of ideology on top of trying to understand it. So, in summary, what is the sexual revolution? It is irrational. It is inhuman. Do you see these three points are all false? It is a fantasy ideology, and people believe they must implement it. They have a great moral charge to implement three things that are false. This means it is a totalitarian ideology. It is a totalitarian fantasy ideology because they're trying to do the impossible. They think they have a high moral duty to do something that cannot be done. It is beyond left and right. Don't get hung up on whether this is a left-wing thing or whether it's a right-wing thing. It's beyond that. And there are people in both political parties who like the sexual revolution just fine. Thank you very much. Okay, so don't be hung up on that. This is an ideology all unto itself, the sexual revolution is. Because it is irrational, it also requires a lot of propaganda in order to maintain it. Because people will be getting counter evidence to it on a daily basis. Right? So, if you really think sex doesn't make babies, there is some pretty solid evidence that could come your way to prove that that's not true. Right? If you believe men and women are completely interchangeable and have no differences, there are plenty of opportunities for you to see otherwise if you're in any kind of intimate relationship with another person, including your brothers and your sisters. You can see that there are differences. And you can see that kids really, truly do need their own parents and would benefit from having their parents wherever that is possible. And that when parents separate or sever the relationship, if we as a culture or we as individuals sever a relationship between a child and their parent, we have done something unjust to that child, unless there's a good reason. And there are some good reasons why that might have to happen. But if we just do it willy-nilly, you know, that's unjust. We shouldn't be doing that. And so we have propaganda telling us that it's all okay. I feel sure that many, many of the people who have gotten divorced, for example, or who have embarked on unmarried parenthood, many of those people did so believing that their kids were resilient and it would all be okay. But if they had really known the impact it would have on their kids, they probably wouldn't have done it. But the whole culture is standing around tamping us down with propaganda and force to maintain. And the most important thing that I want to leave you guys with here is that this is a pagan ideology. This is not a Christian ideology at all, and no Christian should have anything to do with it. And the reason we are where we are, my friends, is because we have allowed too many things to kind of slip by. thinking they weren't significant, thinking they weren't important, thinking it wasn't going to matter very much, okay? So we have to get that out of our minds. Now, unfortunately, the sexual revolution has been with us for at least 40 or 50 years, and I have created a book called The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims, which is a collection of essays that I've written over the past 20 years. And if you look at the image on the cover of this book, here's the physical copy, and there's the image up there on the screen. Can you see who that is on the screen? It's Marilyn Monroe, right? And we think Marilyn Monroe is a perfect metaphor for the sexual revolution in this way. She's beautiful. She's glamorous. She's famous. It's all fun. It's wonderful. At my hotel last night, I saw a product you could buy, I think it was a t-shirt, that had her image on it. All these years after her death, she's still being marketed as an image of glamour and so on. But if you look past that image, what you see is a terrible life. She died at an early age from a drug overdose. We don't know for sure whether it was suicide, murder, or accident, but who cares at the age of 39 dying from a drug overdose? You know, I mean, really. She sexually exploited other people sexually exploited her, and according to her biographer, she had 12 abortions during her life. Can you imagine? And all of that is airbrushed out of sight so that we can keep believing in the glamour and the allure of the sexual revolution. It's a perfect metaphor for what all of us are dealing with in dealing with this toxic ideology.
Just been listening to Dr. J's talk, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims, at the Summit Leadership Conference at California's Biola University. There was a Q&A session afterward, too. It's available for download over at the Ruth Refuge. Check out all the other neat stuff the Refuge has to offer by clicking on the Ruth Refuge section of our website. Check out our regular podcast series, too, for the second part of this talk. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook, like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.